Welcome back, Dota 2 fans. It's game three. Decider matchup versus Flipside Tactics versus Brood Mothers. Winner gonna move on to the grand finals game on Dota 2 Invitational. And Flipside just kind of looking lackluster in their communication and their team fight synergy and their chemistry altogether. In game two, they came out of the lanes with a pretty good scenario, especially considering how well their Void had done in the offlane, dragged over a lot of support too, a lot of commitment to that bot lane when they did bring him down, and came out with good levels, but it just seemed like better execution, better movement altogether from Broodmothers to win them that game two.
We kind of saw similar things in game one from the Broodmothers as well. Like, they ended up losing that game, yes, but it kind of feels like they got cheesed out of that game just by like losing that one push and then instantly losing that one fight, then instantly losing Raxes. Mm-hmm. Like, usually the game is a little bit more methodical about that. And Broodmothers were, you know, in a decent spot to, I think, make a comeback if given it a little bit of extra time. But in game two, being able to patiently grind that one out, and Flipside were very impatient with how they took those fights. They never really absorbed a loss without, you know, sending a couple more bodies in to make an even greater loss. And at a certain point, you got to cut that out. You got to cut your losses, say, okay, so-and-so, you're dead. We're just going to accept that, and we'll try to save everyone else. But for Flipside Tactics this time, going to switch it up a little bit, grabbing the IO first. So we've seen now three different openings from Flipside, and this one is a pretty good opening if you really are intent on saving everybody, because IO can certainly do that.
Yeah, they're going to open with a defensive support duo here, and one thing they were unable to do was to counteract this single target initiation onto their cores in the last game. They had a Doom Phoenix support duo, and neither of those really that great at sustain. Both of these heroes in the IO and the Disruptor can look to counter initiate, and most of the counter aggression was on the back of the Void for Schauchlo in the last game. And although he was successful in saving a couple of his cores, utilizing that Chronosphere, that big teamfight tool that they need to win fights in a defensive nature, often still would bode well for Broodmothers in the fight thereafter. Even if they were able to save one core, all the firepower of Flipside had been expended, and they could continue to press forward, deal damage over time, and win the fight. So IO gonna be not only a target that's gonna garner some of this single target focus, but one that can save a core who's initiated on from distance.
Get an ally gripped, suddenly you swoop in and save him. Pretty clean plays there, at least a clean plan there from the Flipside Tactics squad, and we'll see how well it's actually able to work out for them. Broodmothers grabbed the Bane because it worked out very well for them, and we'll see if they want to go back for the Mirana. Had a pretty clean time, but I do feel like most of the success from the Mirana came because Flipside were kind of making that mistake and sending heroes in one at a time. Like, if they actually all converged at the same time, we would have seen the weakness of Mirana, but that just never happened. So picking up a Mirana kind of right out of the blue, especially up against the Disruptor with Glimpse, seems a little bit less likely in this game. They're going to opt for the Earth Spirit instead. It's kind of weird to see a game where both teams pick all their supports in the first phase.
Yeah. Broodmothers with a very aggressively slanted support duo. Flipside Tactics with a support duo that is good at chasing, but they need their levels first before doing so. And this lineup from Brood, they will be able to kind of get active on the aggressive from level one. So Flipside in that sense are going to take a little bit more to come online. But these two ultimates in the Relocate and the Static Storm could definitely prove to be very influential thereafter. So I think Flipside, the other thing about this opening is that it is going to, in essence, force them to play team-oriented Dota, where they didn't seem like they were on the same page in Game 2, and even for the majority of Game 1, as you alluded to earlier. So, you know, IO plus 1 always going to have to be talking with one another. They're always going to have to be communicating as a team as to, you know, when are there opportunities to be able to turn fights with this Relocate? When are there opportunities to be able to open fights? Who are they going to chase and look to glimpse back? So I like the opening from them in that it forces their hand and forces them to play together, and doesn't, in that sense, allow Broodmothers to play this pick-off style-oriented Dota. They were so good at it with the grip, with the Hawk Vision, the Moonlight Shadow, the Roar last game, just able to kind of gain numbers advantages instantly at the beginning of most engagements, and Flipside had a very difficult time recovering from that deficit thereafter.
And well, Flipside at least also do have some map mobility options with this IO as well, which is a pretty big reason why they won game one, just having flexibility with that map. DK now going to be banned out. Another winner there for Flipside, at least in their first game. But yeah, being able to be assertive just by getting those random pickoffs and opening up doors elsewhere, especially now with the puck, who can generally do very much so similar things, maybe on a slightly lower scale range-wise, but will offer Flipside a lot more in the way of initiation options, which really was difficult for them in the last game. It was pretty much exclusively them getting initiated upon. And yeah. I mean, with the Bane and Earth Spirit, you wouldn't be surprised to see them getting initiated upon at least sometimes in this game. But you know, you would think that there would be a little bit more consideration for Batrider, since it does seem to be just so important for these two teams to get the jump.
And on, with the relocate on top of it, definitely a great hero to have for Flipside, but it is a rough game for a puck. He's going to rely on the relocate save or potentially a static storm at least a couple of times. And you know, you usually rely on your phase shift, but with the grip, with the Fiend's grip and the geomagnetic grip, and now the Chronosphere on top of that. Now, this is a very difficult game for a puck, so it's going to, I feel like a lot of the team fight going to be on the back of Flipside's IO. If he's able to save one core from a major ultimate, such as a grip or a chronosphere, then I think it bodes well for Flipside thereafter. Broodmothers are a little bit more cooldown dependent in this matchup than they were in the last one. The only big cooldown they had to fight around in game two was that Primal Roar, and they were able to find openings often, very often, with S224J on the Beastmaster. So we'll see what kind of work they're able to get done here, but Void works well with IO plus one. He also works well with Puck. So I guess just not willing to give that over. And it is a great hero to have up against the IO plus one.
Yeah, just seeing them come in, just drop a bubble on them. Easy peasy there. My concern is that for Faceless Void, his supporting cast already being selected are not really heroes that put damage in. Yeah. Like, the damage is very low on the Earth Spirit. Bane has a decent amount, but it's more so control than damage is what the hero brings to the table. So, and what you see is more or less what you get. There's no Phoenix combos or anything like that for Broodmothers. So they will have to maybe look a little bit more towards kind of these AoE damaging heroes in their core positions. Gyrocopter of last game, kind of the game plan from Flipside. Not sure if it's going to be the same plan for the Broodmothers, but that Invoker probably still the most reasonable pick they can make here.
Yeah. Definitely looking at the Invoker, the Queen of Pain, another one on their radar, just for the ability to blow up the Wisp early and often. Flipside going to pick up one of the heroes towards the mid lane that is more, well, I guess it could be towards the off lane with the IO, but one of the heroes that is more catering to their playstyle. Jump up in your face, put a battering ram in front of the towers, have some serious initiation potential elsewhere with the puck and potentially the relocate and just the tether move speed in general. So I feel like Viper, a good pickup for them in the sense that if you expend your grip on him, if you expend your Chronosphere on him and you're unable to kill him off, Flipside can definitely have the inclination to re-engage, chase deep, find kills, and then off the back of it, objectives. Viper, a little bit of an underrated pusher. The Nether Toxin does tend to kick in later on during building pushes. And with the IO overcharge behind him, corrosive skin plus the damage reduction from the overcharge, he is a very tanky and a suboptimal target to be initiating on for Broodmothers with one of these big ultimates.
A little bit of guessing game as well. It looks like it might be an offlane puck here. Flipside, if Viper is actually going to take towards the mid lane, there are options here at least for the Flipside squad. And as you said, Viper very well positioned up against Broodmother's heroes. Perhaps the awkwardness of the lanes for Flipside is just going to be mitigated by the sheer strength of this hero alone. Lifesteal the pick for the Broodmother team, and that is going to be very difficult, actually, for Flipside to handle. I mean, the IO can help out, of course, should anyone get caught by that Lifestealer. You do have the poison from the Viper, which can slow him down as well. But for the most part, Puck versus Lifestealer is... I mean, you can't really get killed easily as the Puck, but you can't really kill the Lifestealer easily either, and Disruptor's kit is not good at all versus Rage. So Broodmothers are going to have a powerhouse right-clicker with Earth Spirit and Faceless Void to initiate him. So this is not the perfect scenario for Lifestealer, but it's close.
I could see them putting the Puck one versus one. They may be giving a little bit too much to the Void in that scenario, but I feel like they could pressure the Lifestealer fairly hard. The Earth Spirit is a hero that wants to roam around. He contributes decently in lane, but he really wants to be able to find numbers advantages, utilize that slow from the Rolling Boulder, chase heroes down, and in a defensive tri-lane scenario, the openings for that are slim to none. So Broodmother's going to go back to the Mirana pickup that they had some success with in game two, and it is going to be once again towards that mid lane. Going to be a difficult matchup, whoever it is, really, for this Mirana, whether it be the Puck or the Viper. And Flipside, you mentioned in game one how some of their plays kind of indicated they looked like they wanted to go home. And Drow Ranger strat, Huskar strat, these are two strategies that want to be ending the game quickly. And not only are Puck and Viper both difficult matchups for Mirana in that mid lane, but now with the extra right click from the Precision Aura, Flipside are going to look to take an advantage out of these lanes, and a sizable one at that, and look to throw this Viper in the front lines, have the Puck to counter initiate and right click down these towers with the Drow Ranger. So I mean, Void always nice to have against the Drow. Moonlight Shadow great against the Drow as well, but it does feel like Flipside do have a very snowball oriented lineup,
and it's going to be hard for Broodmothers to kind of overpower their lane, their opponent's lanes. Earth Spirit is definitely going to be useful here, but ganking Viper or Puck with an Earth Spirit is going to be difficult, so they really have to try to focus their attention, therefore, on these supports. And you're lacking the kind of Earth Spirit Darkseer combo that you really need to pressure supports on an enemy off lane, at least to make it easy. So for Flipside, their lanes are looking awfully strong. They have the tanky frontliner, at least in theory, on the Viper, and as long as Seedoy has his positioning correct, then the gap closing tools of Broodmothers, the Earth Spirit, the Faceless Void will be hard to hit onto the Drow Ranger, for one thing, and hard to hit on the Drow Ranger, and also make sure the Io is not able to help the Drow should that occasion arise. So Broodmothers are going to have to lock down their lanes really hard, mostly through this Earth Spirit. Like, this, more so than others, is going to be a lane where, or is going to be a game where Relax has to find a lot of success. But again, I'm not really sure if that's in the cards given the current lane setup for Flipside. It's so hard to get kills on these heroes. Like, even going for Drow Ranger, like, it should be, in theory, pretty easy. But then, like, if you just get gusted back, like, all your offensive power is gone.
Yeah, there's a potential for a glimpse there as well. And that was exactly the question that raised in my mind when you were talking about the importance of the Earth Spirit in this early game. Is who do you really go on out of all these lanes? The Viper, he's just naturally tanky and resistant to these ganks. He's going to turn and put a lot of damage into you. If he gets one TP, should be able to draw at least evenly in the mid lane. And, you know, they are going to need a leap forward from the Mirana with an arrow in order to bring him down to Nihil attempt in the bot lane onto that ward. But some nice warding at least dropped down by the Radiant early on. They're going to know where these supports are in terms of the Io and the Disruptor if they're behind the Viper. And that is, I feel like, the lane most susceptible to the ganks, despite it being a Viper, is going to be this mid lane. I feel like the Io is going to give some attention over to Shotslow early on with the Puck. And in general, he's just very elusive. So unless they're able to kind of hit a Nightmare into Arrow with Shotslow stepping out of bounds, I feel like probably the mid lane being the one most susceptible.
The Mirana is going to take towards that mid lane, and you can even at least pressure the Io if you're actually able to catch an angle on him with the Rolling Boulder. So there are definitely options here, some options here for the Broodmother side, but yeah, in general, it's going to be more difficult than not to make that happen. Viper with Nether Toxin and Precision Aura is obnoxious to lane against, and they're going to miss their starting role on Relax, and definitely not a good start to the lane, that's for sure. And we even see Tamo Wild grabbing Nether Toxin as well, so I don't know the exact total damage with that Nether Toxin when it hits, but it's a lot. It is a lot, and Mirana is kind of one of these lower damage heroes, so competing with the Viper in this lane is possible for right now, but is not going to be super easy moving forward, especially as Seedoy gets more experience on this top lane, though currently has absolutely no experience somehow.
Yeah, Void does seem like he'll have a good lane, however, and the Beastmaster did do a lot of work for this offlaner for the Broodmothers, so it feels like that's a silver lining for this early game for Broodmothers, even if their Earth Spirit is not able to get all that much done. But as we mentioned a moment ago, Vanskor on the IO is going to give a lot of tension over to Shotslow in the early game, ensure that this puck is going to get enough. The Drow Ranger isn't really threatened, even with the Earth Spirit potentially roaming in. There's always a glimpse back, a kinetic field, and these two melee heroes do need to right-click her down, although they can open on her. So, you know, we talked about Tame My Wild being relatively tanky, and that certainly makes sense from Flipside to bring this IO to the bot lane, help Shotslow to spam out the orbs, find a few a little bit of CS, and just make it more difficult to open up with this Bane.
And the Viper really doesn't benefit all that much from having an IO. You could probably just have the IO maybe help set up for Faceless Void kills once you have a couple points in glimpse, but that's going to be a long ways away. You know, being able to keep up with the Mirana is nice from Tame My Wild, but in general shouldn't be a giant issue for him. Like, he's right now just working with a vast damage advantage in the lane, and of course the poison attack, so he can harass freely without drawing aggro, and even if he does get hit, corrosive skin, so it's not really going to damage him all that much. Mm-hmm. Just the lane is just so overwhelmingly in favor of the Viper here that he doesn't really need the extra help, and that's why we're seeing the those stats being reflected now in the CS, as the Dire side slowly start to creep up on a lead. Not going to be a huge one for sure, but for Flipside, really, it's just a race to level 6 for Drow Ranger, and then we'll see what sort of havoc they can cause.
Yeah, even a minor lead can be amplified pretty heavily once they pick up the 6 on the Drow Ranger. This lineup certainly has the ability to be able to stand in the face of towers, and bot lane Shotslow, even with the Wisp overcharge behind him, going to be able to jaunt back out. And now that the Earth Spirit has used his toolkit, they'll go and throw some harass in, try and pull this wave out as well and get a little bit of extra experience. It's not as if they've really stymied the farm of the Lifestealer thus far, but as you mentioned, just not really providing any opportunities for this Earth Spirit. And you know, Broodmothers do rely on the Earth Spirit, not to necessarily gain them a huge advantage in the early game, but at least to stifle the timings of this push to come out with the Drow Ranger. And, he's yet to be able to accomplish that.
They'll roll in one more time, catch the only target they really can kill in the IO, stun them up, do everything really from the Earth Spirit, and still no kill. As long as Vanskor doesn't get initiated upon, I think this lane should be fine. It's getting to a point perhaps where Vanskor with an empty bottle can't really afford to keep Shotslow alive for that long. At least if he does, it's not going to be super safe. He's going to salve him up right now, but with no bottle, the lane is certainly a lot more fragile here for the Broodmother, for the Flipside squad, if Broodmothers just want to go and flip the aggro switch. You know, we'll see if they're going to do that anytime soon, but we have a free farming Drow Ranger up on the top lane, a free farming Viper over in the mid lane as well, both of whom are pretty much crushing their lanes. So this situation for Broodmothers is very quickly going to result in some lost towers.
Yeah.
If they're not able to get anything aggressive going with this Earth Spirit, who is almost exclusively hanging around this bottom lane to very little avail, barely pressuring Shotslow, actually. Shotslow is still doing just fine, and towards top lane, Void is going to teleport out. Glimpses have already been used. Force him out, and now Void already being forced to teleport out once. The lane's not going to get easier for him. In fact, it's going to get nothing but harder.
Yeah, we kind of just mentioned there being very few openings for the Earth Spirit, and this is also where, you know, in game two you find some merits to the Mirana pick, but you just mentioned kind of her lack of tempo controlling. She can't really jump into the fights as a forerunner. Has, you know, if she initiates using the leap, has no way to get out, and it does feel like this Mirana, once the push comes, or the impending push is underneath the structures of the Radiant, just doesn't offer all that much. I mean, even if to get into range for a Starfall and try and clean up the wave is extremely risky.
Yeah, she could still offer an arrow, and at that point for Flipside, you know, if one of your soft heroes gets arrowed, pretty much a non-Viper hero, then you're probably going to have to relocate out or just straight up lose that hero. Trying to fight over that hero is difficult, because in doing so you'll tend to clump up with the Faceless Void. So still like these freehand arrows from Mirana is going to keep her not completely irrelevant, but still not as relevant as they would really like a mid lane hero to be. Like, you really want to be able to stun a hero, or, you know, have that amount of contribution in that fight, while at the same time having some significant burst damage. That's like where, again, Invoker would have been a great hero for Broodmothers, although, yeah, that was banned up towards down towards bottom lane now. Shotch, though, is going to get brain sapped. He does have the help from the IO. Overcharge is going to get the short blink out. Now, here comes the Viper. Will slow down focus just a touch. That will let Shotch, though, escape. He's going to turn around for an orb. Tame a Wild sleeping. We'll get pulled off by the IO. Can Viper land one more poison attack? Yes, he can. That should get the kill with one more attack following. Yes, first blood. Drawn by the Viper. Verona looking for a cheesy kill onto Shotchlo, but is spotted and will leap up into the lane, into the jungle rather. It will be a first blood for Flipside and first blood for a Viper. That's never really what you want to see. A Viper with the most CS on the board, even.
Yeah, and Precision Aura behind him as well. So, you know, early mechanism certainly on the menu for Flipside. Drow Ranger completely free farming, uncontested in this top lane as well. Tied up with the Viper atop the CS board, so things going swimmingly thus far. And, you know, it's where a Queen of Pain may have just netted you the return kill and perhaps one on the Wisp as well. But Amarana, you know, being around that level 6 mark just doesn't offer as much. I mean, Tame My Wild is a full level ahead of this Marana and was able to contribute that Viper strike to the bottom lane where the Marana jumps in and doesn't even have the Moonlight Shadow to try and save her comrade in the Bane.
Marana's just not having a great time up here. Faceless Void is, I guess, to his credit, not dying up towards top lane. He's getting quite a bit of experience as well, slightly ahead of the puck, although that is a dual lane scenario. At a certain point, a glimpse is going to land, and then he's going to have no counterplay, but that glimpse is not going to be it. The Metrum's going to have to try again next time, but Seedoy's ultimate is now up. Gonna go straight for the Precision Aura first build. Right now, plus 31 to everybody. Mm-hmm. So just like out CSing the Viper at this stage is so hard for the Marana. She took 3 shots from the Viper and ended up at this amount of health.
Yeah, picked up.
What do you do about that? You have to try to look for kills elsewhere, but the Faceless Void, Chronosphere isn't up yet. Bottom lane, I mean, it is already with 3 heroes. Is a 4th hero really gonna help that much? Is the risk of not getting a kill and just wasting the hero's time gonna be worth the potential of getting a kill on an IO? It's really hard for this Marana to have an impact until this Faceless Void gets level 6. Then they have a chance. Then they might be able to kill off the Drow, assuming the Disruptor doesn't have anything to say about that, assuming there's no TPs. And that is, of course, a lot of assumptions.
Tame My Wild looks to be building into that mechanism. Does pick up a Haste Rune, can go towards this top lane and at least take this low-hanging fruit in the offlane tower. A couple of Band of Elven skins picked up here by Sadoi. He's going to have that Dragonlance soon, which will allow him to siege from effectively safe range with the Viper being in front of him. And now Tame My Wild going to look to wrap here in the offlane as S2 is looking to soak his level 6 desperately and find the Chronosphere. But now with this Triumvirate of Heroes underneath the tower, it's going to get very difficult for Broodmothers to defend. We'll see if they TP anyone in or if they look to make a move bottom lane. Focus, he's going to show himself in lane. And the IO is up near the top lane. I don't think Vanscore has shown yet, though. So they don't really know that Shotzo is a little bit more vulnerable than he has been for the last bit. But there it is, sub 9 minutes in the first tower of the game, gonna drop. No real contest, and Flipside don't even have to group as 5 in order to do so. In the meantime, Marana doesn't really find much of a trade mid lane. Shotchlo, he's gonna find his Dream Coil on the puck, and really it feels like Flipside should be able to hit their stride pretty hard here coming soon.
I mean, they just took down that tower like nobody's business, and they were still getting farm elsewhere. Maybe not in the mid lane, so Marana gets a little bit of a reprieve. But, I mean, the Dragonlance, is it up yet for the Drow? It's, yeah, once this item is up, and it is going to be up soon once the Courier gets out here, then Drow Ranger is, you know, not only going to be doing more damage and whatnot from a safer range, but I mean, just is harder to kill. Having an Ogre Clubs with strength treads, with the almost ability of IO to jump in and save her. Like, what do you do there as Broodmothers? You're going to have to concede at least these outer tier 1 towers. Get ready to see Flipside grouping up with a handful of heroes over in mid. No Drow Ranger, no problem. They still have the damage from her aura. Marana is looking at Vanscore in the meantime. Arrow, he's going to kiss it, and he will get the Bounty Rune in the end. So IO's gonna have a full bottle. They're looking at the Faceless Void up towards the top lane. Looks like they can't quite glimpse him back, but they're taking towers in the meantime, so not getting kills is not a big deal as long as they get this tower in mid lane, and they should.
Yeah, they have the Dream Coil at the ready. Shotchlo, he's gonna contribute towards this mid lane, building into a Veil, help buff up his team's damage, and Disruptor will have the Static Storm very soon. I feel like the Static Storm and the Relocate are the last pieces to the puzzle for Flipside, and that's why they've been a bit tentative. Top lane, though, they're gonna have to use the Chronosphere defensively, and now in a lot of trouble is as to a couple more right clicks with that Dragonlance. The Moonlight Shadow won't be there in time, and with the Chronosphere off the board, they may just be able to push forward Static Storm, relocate or not towards this mid lane, which actually is going to be denied now. So take a little bit of gold away from a much needed gold away from this Drow Ranger lineup, but no real reason for them not to push forward in this top lane, and they will end up doing so. Moonlight Shadow off the board, Dragonlance ready for Sadoi. They've got the Chronosphere utilized as well, so Tame My Wild gonna group up in the front and does have most of the mechanism done as well in base when he can when he has time to bring that out.
The Lifestealer is still getting an incredible amount of farm in this bottom lane. So once he joins the fight with the Armlet, which is coming up not too far away from now, he will have a pretty significant impact, assuming he doesn't get, you know, Viper Strike and then kite it to death, which is always a threat. Flipside gonna grab that tower, Drow Ranger in the lead with the Viper as far as the farm is concerned, and the mechanism is ready on the Viper as soon as the Courier gets out here. So there's really nothing stopping Flipside from just continuously rotating around and doing exactly what they've shown they can do over towards these tier 1s and even at these tier 2s. Mm-hmm. At a certain point, you can't use your Chronosphere defensively. Like, even if you die, it's acceptable. You need the Chronosphere in order to have a hero get on top of the Drow Ranger, because it's either the Faceless Void does it, or you land a sick arrow, or the Earth Spirit needs a perfect angle. It's very difficult to get rid of that agility bonus for Drow Ranger. And if you can't get rid of that, you're probably just going to be kited to death and just torn apart by the plus 40 damage now on everybody. Tame My Wild, by the way, has an Invis Rune. He's looking at an Earth Spirit with a Glimpse available and a Static Storm. Relax is going to turn around, try to kill the Disruptor, but he's actually going to do a decent job. Get the kill, but immediately die afterwards towards the Viper. Not a bad trade, all honestly, for the Earth, but again, it's not going to stop anything. It's the push is still coming.
Yeah, bot lane, shot slow pressuring in, and mid lane, they are going to assemble here. It's a bit costly for Vanskor just because he does want that relocate fairly desperately and was not able to get the experience the Disruptor dropping there was not able to get the experience from that kill. But his Static Storm is up, the relocate to come up soon. And this five man just looks very scary. They can either choose to Roche or take this safe lane tower. And it'll look like they'll go for the ladder and then maybe the Roshan attempt thereafter. Infest Bomb available with a Bane here, and they will drop it out. Sadoi in a bit of trouble, but they get the Static Storm there to cover him. And although it won't bring the Lifestealer down, it will force him out. And that is going to be more than enough time for them to take this tier 1 with the kill on the Bane. They'll get rid of the trees as well, that no TPs can come through in the fog, and tier 1 will go down with relative ease. They will trade one though in the meantime, top lane with the Morana and the Void, and they do have the Chronosphere, so really not the worst set of events against this Drow Ranger lineup for Broodmothers. But smoke comes out, and now the Roche attempt should be a very quick one coming out from this Direside lineup. They are rotating over with the Earth Spirit, but not sure that they really want to fight into this. Shotslow has his Dream Coil and his Veil at the ready. There's a Gust as well from the Drow Ranger. Really, the only thing they're missing is going to be that Static Storm.
They'll stun up a couple, but then still push up towards top, but Void, unlike Beastmaster, is not a hero that can significantly raise this. So Drow will grab her second life. Lifestealer in that bottom lane engagement got into melee range, which is like always the hardest part for Lifestealer, but still can't at this point outrace a bottle with an IO tether with bottle and overcharge, even when he's attacking into this Drow Ranger, who didn't really start that fight off with a lot of health, but still with the Dragonlance, half her HP is still going to be a decent amount of health with the IO behind her. So flip side, they walk in, grab the Aegis, grab the bottom lane tier 1 tower, and continuously will push in towards these lanes. Top lane still being pushed in by the Void, by the Slardar, but again, look how glacially slow they are. Void's hitting for like 20 damage a pop versus the armor of the tower. In the meantime, Sidoi is doing a hell of a lot more than that. Tier 2 tower is going to be brought down, and Flipside, knowing Flipside, are probably just going to go straight up for high ground, because why the hell not? You got the Aegis, you got all your big ultimates, with the exception being the IO ultimate. That one is a big one, but you're going to at least force some heroes back. So that in of itself is a nice little win. Dragonlance can keep the Drow Ranger at a safe range. And the tower's already down at half HP. Like, the creep wave hasn't even started hitting the tower yet.
Yeah, the relocate is a bit of a concern, them not having that up just yet, but Sadoi does have the second life, and they've got the mechanism on Tame My Wild as well. So there is some real counter, and very real counter initiation potential, and As you mentioned, the Dragonlance kind of allows them to safely siege here. The Moonlight Shadow will be popped up. Maybe they'll look to engage with a grip here. They will get the Chronosphere, but it's only going to connect onto Metrum in the back lines. So they've got the Coil on top of this. It will land. Infest Bomb is going to come out. They kill off the Disruptor. Waning Rift will come out. And Vanskor, he's going to drop on the Wisp. Sadoi still standing tall and fighting in the front lines. Time dilated up. Couple more right clicks will bring down this Drow Ranger. She does have the Aegis available, though. And now Vanskor, with the experience from that fight, will relocate back in to heal up Sadoi. We'll have to jump out back out to base on the Wisp, but we'll get Sadoi back into fighting shape before doing so. Now they're going to look to find the Void. They're going to veil him up, try and chase him down with the orb, but he's just going to look to delay for the time being. Vanskor TP's into the mid lane, and they'll continue to whack away at the high ground with the Chronosphere off the table. Tame My Wild's mech cooling down soon. Aegis still up for Sadoi. They can continue to force this issue on the high ground. The arrow will connect onto Tame My Wild, and there is no Disruptor in this fight just yet. He's coming in soon, though. Can he get the glimpse back? Not in time, but does have a Static Storm. Will drop it onto at least the Mirana. Will glimpse back the Earth Spirit as well. Satchel needs a little bit of extra damage in onto these cores. The Thunder Strike will finish off the Earth Spirit, though. Mirana down, does have buyback available. May need to expend it here to save the melee racks, and Flipside will be relatively content with that Mirana buyback. At least looking to back out and reset. Arrow going to fly through, not going to connect onto anyone. Glimpse back onto the Bane. Nightmare onto Vanskor for the time being. And now the Mirana up in the front lines will back them out with Tame My Wild being down. But they get that Mirana buyback. They get the tier 3 for the time being. And Shoshlo doesn't even lose the Aegis. However, you know, it'll expire here in 2 minutes. But still, a pretty big win for Flipside. It's not as if they have a split pushing hero, you know, who's using the boot to travel to farm elsewhere. So Broodmother's really getting nothing out of this window.
Goes up. They're going to spot out Sidoa. He is actually going to get value off of this Aegis, it looks like, although they're going to ignore him. Go for the puck instead. He just now gets his coil back up now, and now they have to try to go for Sidoa Vanskor. He does have a relocate out. Is not going to start channeling that up just yet. Sidoa is just going to grind everyone down. Doesn't even need the backup. Glimpse is going to cancel the TP. They'll grab the Lifestealer, and now the Mirana has to Moonlight Shadow. She just had that one back up. But Sidoa and Tame My Wild, the two damage-dealing heroes, serious damage-dealing heroes of Flipside, survive in Vanskor. Able to keep Sidoi firing. It looks like my claim of using the Aegis not going to be true this time either. That was a fight without a Static Storm, for one thing. I think their coil was just cooled down when the puck just died, or was a couple seconds away, but either way, it wasn't really there. So that fight was not even the best fight that Flipside could have taken. It just shows off how much damage they can do. Sidoi holding his ground up against an Earth Spirit, even without that agility bonus. But at this point, level 3 overcharge, it's almost as good as marksmanship. It's certainly going to be helping him do quite a lot of damage. And he's got the Dragonlance, he's got the Yasha, he's moving pretty quick. He can kite with the best of them, as can Viper, who's also gone for this Dragonlance.
Has an ultimate orb on the courier as well, so going to be a very early Manta style up on Sadoi. And yeah, you mentioned the front line definitely being there. They secured the gem as well, which was on the puck, so they were able to net that back even after the puck dies. It would have been nice for the Broodmothers to pick that up, but now it'll just be these lower hanging fruits in the outer tier towers, or the last outer tier tower being taken down by Flipside. That'll give them a little bit of an extra influx of income as well. Shoshlo, he's got enough for a blink, so can look to pick that up here from the side shop before the next fight. But there's a smoke out coming from Broodmother's Tame My Wild. He's a bit out of position, and they do have the Infest Bomb on to relax. They jump forward. They will find the Chronosphere onto Sadoi. Now Vanskor, he's relocated in, though. Glimmer Cape going to throw that up onto the Drow. Gust connects onto two. They Infest Bomb onto the backline, trying to bring down the Wisp, but he gets mecked up by the Viper, and they will get the Earth Spirit as the trade. Now Tame My Wild trying to chase forward to find focus. His Rage is down. They will get the one Poison attack off and another. This should be enough to slow him down. TP in from Sadoi as well with the Frost Arrows. And yeah, Armlet Targling not going to save the LS here. 50 seconds on the sidelines. Mirana, the only one left for this lineup of the Radiant side. And Broodmothers are staring down the barrel of defeat and elimination from Game On, the Dota 2 Invitational here. They still have the coil available. Static Storm was utilized in that fight, but Manta Style fully completed on Sadoi. There's really no reason not for them to poke at this high ground without the Lifestealer and the Chronosphere or Broodmothers.
Chronosphere on Sidoy is great, but with no damage follow-up, it was just a disable. There was nothing else. Like, even Faceless Void wasn't comfortably hitting Sidoy, so you land your biggest ultimate on the correct target, but to what end? The end of your Raxes, that's what end. And now the return of the Disruptor and the Io are going to facilitate the secondary portion of this push. No Static Storm yet, no Relocate yet. But those will be up by the time Flipside want to go for their second set of Raxes. Alternatively, wait a couple minutes for Roshan. I think if it was any team but Flipside, a team would probably do that, and I'd probably be okay with that. But again, Flipside want to go home. They're tired of playing this game, so they're just going to go ahead and group up on the bottom lane and start pushing that one out as well. Are there any big cost-effective items that they could pick up to really shove this push in? 2,700 gold on the Viper, similar amount of gold on the Drow Ranger. I mean, it really depends on what they want to build up in the future, but after taking your racks up already, I think it should be time for Flipside to think about just how do we take the second set, because that essentially ends the game.
Yeah.
Like, even getting a Hyperstone, which is something you probably won't want to build into with anything significantly, is going to be good here, just because it adds more DPS.
Yeah, I don't mind the Maelstrom coming out as well for the Viper, but either way, definitely want to build for the now, look to end the game. Sidoy will deal with top lane, and they are stalking him. But he does get the denial off on the tower, and Vanskor is positioned defensively behind him, so Chronosphere or not, should be able to save his Drow Ranger. They'll shove out the top wave, and it looks like because of that, Flipside are going to be waiting for this next Roshan. Could be an opening for Broodmothers, however, they do fight decently around this pit. They do have the Moonlight Shadow to initiate as well, but I mean, gem up onto Shotchlo and expect even more detection around the pit, or at least observer wards for an extra bit of sight. And Shotchlo, as we mentioned, picked up that blink not too long ago, so feels like Flipside, even around the Roche pit, should be able to initiate and at least keep the Infest Bomb in the Earth Spirit at bay.
Broodmothers, I mean, they've been starting the fights in a semi-decent manner, just they haven't had the right heroes at the right place at the right time. The Aghanim's Mirana is definitely going to help their case, however, there is a Glimmer Cape on the Io, and you're going into Corrosive Skin Viper, so it's not always going to be you able to just jump in and get a burst kill, but at least Broodmothers now have a little bit of extra damage outside of this Lifestealer, so even if he gets caught in a Chronosphere with an Infest or whatever, it's still possible for Broodmothers to make some sort of counterplay around that. And of course, you know, you don't want to catch your life in a Chronosphere in any way, so hopefully for them that doesn't happen, but I'm not sure if they're going to get that much time to set that up. There's a minute 30 until there's Roche. Flipside going to get Yasha on their Viper, a nice cost-effective item there, and a big agility item here from Sidoy. Hyperstone be damned. The Eagle Song is going to make the Precision Aura give a cool 77 to everybody. That's a double damage for the Io. I mean, that's it's probably not like the best example, I suppose, but over towards mid lane, they're going to jump in towards Focus. Single coil for him. Relocation coming in as well. Focus needs to invest into something. He's not going to have anything to jump into, though. He's down. Ill's going to teleport out, but no Lifestealer is the vast majority of Broodmother's fight right now. And without him, can they actually kill off any of these Flipside heroes through an Io?
Yeah, this may just convince Flipside that the Roshan not really all that necessary with the 30-second window to go towards the high ground. The lanes are in a fairly favorable position, and they will assemble towards the bottom lane. They only use the coil there. Relocate used as well, but it will be up on the high ground, and Sidoy feels pretty darn survivable. 26 armor plus 2 with all the agility that she has. She's got the Dragonlance to keep herself back from really the front lines of the fight, and they'll throw Tame My Wild up on the high ground as well. They've got Shotchlo to counter initiate with the Blink Dagger, so it feels like a pretty safe siege, at least to punish the Lifestealer death for now. They may look to back and take this Roche momentarily, but they will get a very significant amount of damage done. The tier 3 is going to be taken off the map in the bottom lane. Jump forward, Chronosphere.
In the back line, Sidoy is outside of it though. Tame of Wild is gripped up in the meantime. Can they kill off anyone first? They kill off Vanskor, but lose Mirana for it. And ultimately, the Chronosphere is going to lead to 2 kills. Not bad, but none of those kills, none of the damage even onto Sidoy. And Shotchlo's going to jump in looking for the Void. Some more right clicks, and he will fall. Now Relax going to fall as well. This Puck is doing so much right click damage. One more arrow, not going to land because of the Moonlight Shadow. And Relax is going to teleport out the Wolves. The Wolves are not going to kill him off. No crits there. Unlucky Flipside, but doesn't matter. They already forced out a buyback. Lifestealer in the meantime gonna get found out by the Puck, killed off as well. Plus 77 will do that for you. Plus 87 at this point, actually. Tamon Wild is going to take all the spells in the world. Double Stars as well with the Gust is going to keep him safe for a little longer. Vanquish goes in return. It's Seedoy and Chachlov now doing all the damage, specifically versus Relax, who doesn't have nearly enough health to sustain up against that. This is a two set of Raxes here for the flip side squad. Seedoy able to not move and just sit there and right-click. That is the Drow Ranger dream, and Broodmothers, even with a great Chronosphere, again, falls short in the follow-up.
Yeah, a little odd there. I mean, the Chronosphere finds two on the back lines, and the Earth Spirit rolls into the Chrono and kind of gets stuck, as opposed to maybe rolling onto the Drow Ranger here and canceling the marksmanship. But Seedoy able to manta up, right-click into all these heroes, and, you know, in the mid lane, we essentially see Shachlo solo killing up the Lifestealer. He finds him out again bottom lane, and when you're getting this much impact from your three position in your Drow lineup, you're certainly pretty content with where you stand. And that's two lanes of Rax, 26 minutes in, going Flipside's way. And, you know, they went for this early tempo lineup, looking to strangle the Radiant side out of the map. And, you know, even with Moonlight Shadow, there just doesn't seem to be a counterplay for the Radiant. There's not enough damage to dump into this Chronosphere quickly enough. They don't have the mobility to catch up with their Void on anyone but the Mirana, and the Gust is able to keep them at bay. The relocate save is possible. You see them grip up Tame My Wild in the front lines, and he's just too tanky to bring down. Even if they do kill him off, it takes far too long, and there's just too much work done from the other cores in the puck and the Drow Ranger. So Flipside seem to have all their bases covered here, and it's going to be a little bit of a desperate times call for desperate measures for Broodmothers. They're going to smoke as five through the Dire Jungle, look to find some sort of straggler. But it looks like Flipside are very well aware of this. They're postured up defensively, up on the high ground. They're using their scans to try and scout the movement of the Radiant, and they're not willing to give up any of their advantage here. Manta Style going to be picked up on the Viper, and they're continuing to look fight ready.
Moke was a desperate play, as you said, from the Broodmothers team. Flipside, they have crit now on the Drow Ranger. I'm not even sure if they can kill her off with the Lifestealer anymore, like in a 1v1, because of that evasion from the Butterfly. Moonlight Shadow now going to be used. They have a pretty good angle on the back end, but that's Tame My Wild who's bringing up the rear, so that's not the hero you want to go towards. Smoke is going to be eventually canceled, as they do find themselves an angle onto the Viper. They have to get on someone else, but Chronosphere only has a shot, though. They will be able to bring him down at the same time, grip Tame My Wild, but again, Seedoy is just free-firing out from the outset, and is going to take down the face of the Void. Relax, also getting wrecked by this Drow Ranger. Tame My Wild still alive thanks to Vanquish's Glimmer Cape, and a Coil's gonna drop off green in the background. That means Mirana's dead. That means the Bane's dead. That means the Lifestealer's dead, and that means Broodmother's game is dead. That's a 28-minute victory. Pretty much textbook Drow Ranger game right here.
Yeah, yeah. This is exactly what you want from your Drow Ranger lineup, and once again, we kind of just see the Earth Spirit rolling in onto a Chronosphere target, and with a Lifestealer in you, you know, it feels like your best chance to fight this lineup is to at least cancel marksmanship and try and bring down the Drow Ranger. But they're unable to do so once again and just get overpowered by this Drow lineup. The lanes went far too well. When you pick an Earth Spirit, you really rely on him to be able to get a lot done in the early game, secure yourself an advantage, delay the timing window of the other team. And it was just very good picking into the Earth Spirit, it felt, from Flipside and from Vanscore. All three lanes did really not feel all that susceptible to the ES.
And Flipside, they finally get their act together and work as a team, right?
Yeah.
So game two is just a momentary hiccup. No big deal.
Mm-hmm. A lot of game one as well. But yeah, it does seem like that IO certainly from Vanscore, especially him being the captain, kind of promoted better team work and team synergy. And, you know, Drow Ranger lineups tend to do the same. So Flipside take a couple of games in under 30 minutes. They have a rough loss in game two and 40, but they will validate you 70% of you voters on esportgaming.com, and the favorites will take this one, go on to the grand finals. They'll face up against Pro Dota Gaming, and, you know, Pro Dota looked pretty good today. Early prediction for that series is that you know, the way Flipside played today, I would say that Pro Dota have a damn good shot at being able to take the grand finals. But, you know, in general and from recent history, I would say that Flipside are probably favored.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. Either way, guys, it's going to be MRP Mike Loris here. We hope you enjoyed the cast. It's going to be all for today. Tomorrow, we will have the grand finals going on. And I believe that's scheduled for 20 CET. I'm just going to bring it up real quick to ensure that. And It's actually 17 CET. So 11 Eastern, 17 CET. Be ready for that. It's going to be the grand finals best of five format. Until then, if you guys enjoyed the cast,
I think it's actually just best of three.
Really? It's a grand finals. That's definitely what it is. But regardless,
I don't know. We'll find out.
Yeah, join us tomorrow. Until then, if you want to drop us a line, blame us a little. You can follow me on Twitter at MRPDota. You can follow my brother in arms at Mike Loris, MIKELORUS. It's all in the title. But until then, thank you guys for joining us. It's been game on. You can catch us more than likely tonight doing some Star Ladder as well. So keep up to date with the Twitters. We'll see you guys back for Game On Dota 2 Invitational tomorrow. GG, guys.